Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I know it's 2:30 or 3 o'clock after lunch, and I know that after lunch people do not have the concentration, but I will try to make it short and to the point. And just before I start, I would like to thank Mark for his kind invitation. It is the third time for me to be here in Berlin. I always adore this city, whatever the conference in the Christmas time, very cold weather, or it is in the summer, in June, because you know it's always the meeting happening here twice, one in June, one in December. So whether in December, I like the weather here, and in June, of course, I have a break to quit the very hot weather back in Cairo, actually. And I really appreciate the work that Mark is doing and what the ICD is doing to gather all these people here in these rooms and during the 2-3 days conference. I understand that most of the speech happening this morning is about the human rights, but from the exact word of human rights, but I will try to handle the human right from a different angle, which is related to the economic growth. Given my background as a professor of finance and my research in economics and also my executive position as the chairman of the Egyptian Stock Exchange, I got the idea from Mark of how to link issues related to the human rights with the economic development. So I'm trying to move a little bit from the exact definition of human rights to something that tackle the issues or the relationship between human rights and economic growth. Actually, if we look to the meaning of the human rights versus economic development in the past, we can see that very few connection has been made between human rights and economic development. So on one side, from the philosophy point of view, you find the war concentrating on the foundational issues in ethics. And from the legal point of view, lawyers, for example, were focusing on the question of the international legal obligations in terms of human rights. So both things, whether we're talking from the philosophy point of view or from the legal point of view, they did not put in their definition the issues related to the institutional, economic, and structural processes that impact the individual freedom and human rights. So in reality, they were concentrating from the philosophical point of view as well as from the legal point of view. On the other side, economists, when they were talking about economic growth and what drives the economic growth around the globe, they did not take into consideration things related to the human rights. So if you look to the economic literature about the drive for economic growth, they were talking about labor, they were talking about capital, they were talking about the macroeconomic stabilization, but they did not take the issues of human rights as one of elements that could affect the economic growth. So on one side, from the philosophy and the legal point of view, they did not put the economic point of view in their definition of the human rights, and economists, they did not take the human rights as one of the elements that could affect the economic growth in the economic development side. So we need to try to find the relationship between economic and political freedom as a necessary decision, a necessary condition for the economic growth and development of a nation. And just for some statistics about the things could affect the economic growth, prosperity, and per capita income. It is not necessarily related to the human rights, but in a sense, if we believe that these things is very important to the human rights, we can find the indirect relationship between human rights and economic growth. For example, a 10% improvement in the voice and accountability of a country, citizenry, leads to about 0.68% increases in its real per capita income. So if the level of accounting accountability, voice and accountability increases by 10% in a country, which is of course, voice and accountability could have an impact of the human rights. Because one of the human rights is to be able to disclose your rights, to disclose your voice, and to bring those are managing the country for accountability in case they are making any mistakes. So if the level of voice and accountability is increased by 10%, which means that the human rights for citizens at large are increasing, that could increase the per capita income of 0.68%. Another thing, a 10% increases in the political stability index of a country is corresponding to about 0.36% rises in real per capita income. Again, if we believe that political stability is a part of the human rights, that we, if you are living in a country that enjoying a minimum level of political stability, this will increase the economic development and will increase the per capita income of a country. A 10% improvement in rule of law and in control of corruption index translated into 0.21 and 0.15% rises in per capita income. Again, although it is not directly putting us in a relationship between human rights and economic growth, but indirectly it is, because if you are living in a country that does respect the rule of law, that does have a less level of corruption, that this country is controlling corruption, we believe this is a part of the human rights. You would like to live in a country that enjoys a rule of law, that everybody, no matter his political connectivity, no matter of his social category, is treated equally. This is the meaning of rule of law. And if this country has control of the level of corruption, it means that you are exercising your human rights. So for us as economists, we do not look to the human rights only in terms of your right to express your voice, your right to elect people in the parliament, your president, but also your right to live in a country that respects rule of laws, enforceability, and have a low level of corruption. And if a country enjoying that, it means it does respect the human rights, and this is have a positive impact in economic growth and a positive impact on per capita income. Again, a 10% improvement in good governance results in around 1%. It's 0.91% increases in real per capita income of a country. And again, it's very important for the people, if they are defending their human rights, to make sure that the country they are living them in, it is governed in a way that has best practice of governance that is treated equally for the people. People have the right to defend themselves. People have the right to participate in the economy at large. And this is, has a good impact on economic growth. And again, a 10% improvement in a country government effectiveness index and the regulatory quality leads to 0.73 and 0.61% increases in its real per capita income, respectively. Again, as I was mentioning from the beginning, it is not directly connecting the human rights to the economic development or to the per capita income, but indirectly, if these things happen in a country in which we are talking about the rule of law, voice and accountability, low level of corruption, better governance, regulatory quality, government effectiveness, it means that you are, as a citizen of a certain country, if you are enjoying this high level of country governance, it means that you are exercising better your human rights, and this is, has a good impact on economic growth and per capita income. Human rights versus economic development. In the past, we should move here, we should move like this. Okay. So, to conclude of what I have saying in the previous slides about the indirect relationship between human rights and economic growth, there are some direct ones. So they said that civil and political rights can reduce the risk of major social and economic disasters by empowering individuals, to complain, keeping government informed, and be part of the policy response, making it easier for marginalized and powerless individuals and groups to make claims. It's very important when we're talking about human rights, as I was mentioning, is not about exercising your votes in an election, but also to feel that the government is listening to what you need, is listening to the problems and the challenging, not facing the entire society, but also more emphasizing those marginalized and powerless people that they are living in a disaster situation, that the government is taking the economic decision as a part of what they are feeling and what they're having. So it is very important when a government is putting a policy decision is not to look to a certain group of people or a certain category of people, but they need to understand that they are managing a country at large and they need to listen more to those marginalized group. Corruption and the elite control of resources is less likely to happen in countries that have respect of human rights. Very important, and this is what we were talking in the previous slides about, that you need to have a country that manage in the right direction and they have a better governance. And one thing is of a better governance or element is about the level of corruption and whether the politically connected people or the elite people are benefiting from their positions or not. So whenever you have the level of corruption is less, whenever you have the rule of law that everybody is treated equally, it means that you have that the corruption and the control of resources is less likely to happen when this country is enjoying a certain level of human rights. So human rights also can be an effective tool for a poverty reduction. And this is, in fact, is a very important point, because for many economists, there is a very important relationship between three parameters. You're talking about economic growth, poverty level, and equality in income distribution. And it is very important when the economic decision making is taking is concentrate of how to strike balance among these three parameters, because in some cases you can achieve a high and sustainable economic growth, but in the meantime, the poverty is not going down by the same level. And in some cases, the equality in income distribution, which is the gap between poor and rich people, in some cases are increasing. Let me give you an example. The World Bank and the IFC has a report 5-6 years ago about the economic and growth dimensions. And they were able to find 13 countries in the world, and they call it Club 13. Club 13 are those 13 countries that they were able to achieve a minimum real GDP growth rate of 7% for at least a continuity of 25 years after the Second World War. One of these countries was India. India was able to achieve around 7-8 and sometimes even double-digit growth rate, 10-11% in the last 30 years, continuously. The poverty went down, but not linearly as the economic growth. But what was disappointing is about the equality in income distribution. There is a measure called Gini coefficient, and Gini coefficient is a measure that measures the differences between the very rich people and the very poor people. And whenever this measure, the Gini coefficient, goes down, it means that the gap is closing or narrow between rich and poor people. In India, this Gini coefficient was around 29.6. Even after 30 years of sustainable economic growth, the Gini coefficient went up to 36 instead of 29. It means even the country was able to achieve a high level of growth rate, a sustainable one, and the poverty has benefited from that, but the equality in income distribution was not there. It means the gap between rich and poor people, instead of narrowing the gap, It's increasing or widening the gap. And this is why it's very important that when you are taking an economic decision, you need to take decision to make sure that citizens at large will benefit from that, and the economic decisions will not impact negatively the poor people on the expenses of rich ones. And this is why we said that if you take a human rights as a part of your elements when you are taking economic decision, it's very important to make sure that citizens at large will benefit from that. Number one, human rights contributes to the empowerment and social protection of marginalized group through social mobilization and the mechanisms of strengthening accountability. Very important that marginalized group will be part of the decision-making process, and very important that a country will strengthen the accountability so decision-makers, they understand they are reporting to the citizen, not to the elite people in the society. Human rights enforce the work and equity and equality by emphasizing non-discriminations, raising a demand for disaggregate approaches and for documentation of how groups are involved and how they participate. And again, when you look to economic decision-making process in a country and how you are helping marginalized group, which is in some cases the majority of the country could be left behind, is not about having only a safety network or having subsidies in your system. This is not the way to help the poor people or marginalized group. It is not a charity issue. But to make sure that they getting equal treatment in terms of health, in education, in the job market, so that the job offered is not limited to the elite people or well-connected people, but to the citizen at large at a fairly merit basis. So to make sure that people are involved, they are part of the decision-making process in the way the country is managed. And this is why you are saying that we need talking about equity and equality. Equality means that the government should put in place policies that to make sure that it will be a sort of narrowing the gap between the very rich people and the very poor people. Now, I'm moving to a different angle about the stock exchanges. Given my position as the chairman of the stock exchange, and some people now can wonder what is the relationship between stock exchange and human rights. And in reality, before I just give a very introductory remarks about the role of stock exchanges, in September 2015 in the United Nations, it has been announced the ending of the Millennium Development Goal that was from 2000 until 2015, and the starting the era of the Sustainable Development Goal from 2015 to 2030. And you are talking about 17 goals and 169 sub-goals. And in this goal, the stock exchanges has been mentioned from the Secretary General of the United Nations after we having the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative back in 2012, that they have a role of how to achieve the SDG or the Sustainable Development Goals that the United Nations put it as a goals from 2015 to 2013. The stock exchanges plays a critical role connecting investors and companies in the market, and this is important part of economy and economic growth, because stock exchange is a source of financing. So companies, they are looking for capital increases, they are looking for expansion, they are looking for injecting more investment, providing more job creation. This could happen through the capital allocation in the stock market. One of the most important roles for stock exchange is to support the economy through providing a source of financing to the private sector, increasing the welfare and the providing opportunities for companies to expand and to grow. Not only the big companies, but also the small and medium-sized companies. And just for your information, if you are hearing about giant companies now, like Yahoo, Sun Microsystem, Google, All these companies did start with a few number of investors with $100,000, and now they around $5-6 billion market capitalization. This would not have been happened if there was no stock market. But having companies go public will increase ownership, will diversify their activities, and will have them access to finance. They will have access to create more jobs in the economy and to contribute to the economic growth in a country. Recently, stock exchanges have paying a lot of attention to sustainability. Now everybody talking about sustainability. Sustainability is not a simple word, but it's a way of living. It's a way of how this world should behave in the future. You're talking about sustainability in economic growth. It means that part of your obligations is to make sure that you are serving your community, you are not damaging your environment, you are having a better planet for the future generation, you are trying to strike balance between achieving profit and protecting your environment. So sustainability is a way of living, it's a new approach. So now we're talking about many things in economic growth. We're talking about a green economy. We're talking about green bond. We're talking about green financing, because we would like this world to move from traditional economy to a green economy. A green economy that is more friendly to the environment to protect our future generation. So the stock exchanges here paying a lot of attention to sustainability and its importance. Most of the sustainability goals contribute directly to human rights by ending corruption, supporting rights for workers, and abolishing child labor. As the chairman of the Egyptian Exchange, I just would like to give you a couple of minutes about the Egyptian Exchange. Egyptian Exchange has been created back in 1881. It was the third oldest stock exchange in the world. And recently, we were a part of the sustainable stock exchanges. We did start even earlier before the initiative taken by the Secretary General back in 2012 in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. We started in 2010 by creating a very important index called ESG. And ESG is standing for Environmental, Social, and Governance Index. And we were encouraging our listed companies to be more committed to the issues related to environment, how to protect your environment, corporate social responsibility, as well as governance. That is very important to make sure that companies are healthier and they are providing their investors with what we call it maximizing shareholders' rights. In 2012, Egypt was one of the only five signatory stock exchanges that they announced a public commitment back in Rio de Janeiro that they are a part of the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative. And this is how the initiative was born. I think it was Egypt, where the Egyptian Exchange was born, Istanbul, with Johannesburg Stock Exchange, Bovespa in Brazil, as well as the NASDAQ Stock Exchange. Those are the five founder stock exchanges that created the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative back in 2012, announced by Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of the United Nations at that time. In 2013, when we have our strategy, sustainability was part of the four-year strategic plan of the Egyptian Exchange. Egyptian Exchange was elected as the as the vice chairman or the vice chair of the sustainability working group at the World Federation of Exchanges. Some of the activities that we have done back home, we have the model for sustainable stock exchange communication to our stakeholders. We're ringing the bell for gender equality in March 2015. We ring the bell also for woman empowerment for the women World Day back in 2015 as well, because we believe that Very important in your strategic plan is to make sure that you are protecting your environment, you are empowering women, and you are achieving equality between genders. And I guess my last slides is about what needs to be done through the creating a relationship between human rights and economic development. We need more consistent enforcement of roles, more efficient court system, empowering women, supporting decentralization, greater legal transparency to engage our stakeholders, improving access to public information. We need stronger corporate disclosure requirements and strengthening auditing and reporting standards. By this, I end my presentation, and thank you for being patient with me.
Thank you very much, Mr. Omran, and we're really happy to have you here as a representative of Egypt and also as one of the few representatives of the private sector, so to speak, coming also from the stock exchange. So in that sense, it's really helpful also to have your perspectives to balance many of the diplomatic, political, and academic perspectives. So I'm sure we would welcome this opportunity to ask questions and also make comments from Mr. Omran. As always, if you could briefly introduce yourself, that would be excellent as well. First here.
Thank you, Professor, for your valuable insights. I'm Himanshu, and I'm an MBA student at the University of London. And I really enjoyed your presentation. I had a question for you, sir. Did you find any correlation between those countries which have human rights issues and inflation?
Inflation.
Did you find, because inflation is a very important factor in describing the economic growth of a country. Like, if you talk about, we just read a case study on Zimbabwe, where the inflation was just, you know, out of the bounds. If you can give me some insights about that, that will be amazing. Thank you so much.
Are you graduate or postgraduate student? Are you grad or postgraduate student?
I'm a postgraduate
student. Okay, so this should be a topic for your coming research, actually. I mean, I did not make an empirical research to understand the relationship between the human rights and the level of inflation. As well as it did not come across my mind to look to the literature about this relationship. But again, if you believe that countries enjoying a certain level of human rights, enjoying a good performance of economic growth, and the enabling factors for economic growth, one of them is to bring your budget deficit down, and of course the inflation, because the relationship between inflation and economic growth is a negative one. So you would understand that to achieve a sustainable high level economic growth, you need to have the inflation down. And if you believe that there is a sort of a relationship between human rights and economic growth, you would assume that indirectly, you should assume that countries with a low level of human rights, they might enjoy a high level of inflation. You mentioned, for example, Zimbabwe. I can mention, for example, Sudan. There are many countries about that. But I mean, I'm not sure in the literature the people make this link, or they just do it through the relationship between human rights and economic growth.
I'd just like to add on to what you said. I think economics, growth, human rights, inflation, when it comes to economics, everything is a balance of all the economic fundamentals. I mean, if you look at inflation and human rights, inflation and economic growth, then you have to put in mind Phillips curve, which is inflation and unemployment. Then what are you compromising? Why are you compromising? What are you pinching to benefit what?
Yeah. So thanks for helping.
How do you see the effect of automation and artificial intelligence on jobs and the level of unemployment that will follow, and how will it affect human rights in combination with economic empowerment, economic furtherance?
Very difficult question to answer. This question has been raised several times, actually, because if you think about it, as you rightly mentioning, the automation happening, the artificial intelligence, and all these things could replace equipment, machines, instead of the human power. So it is really very open question. See, even economists this year debating on whether this will have an impact on the job creation and the unemployment. The reality is that, look to the United States, even with all this kind of technology we have, I think the United States is one of the countries that have a very low level of unemployment. I mean, now it's standing at 5% or less, even than 5%. While even in other countries, while they have less automation like those in emerging markets or those in the Middle East, for example, you will have the double-digit unemployment rate. So in reality, the fact is that sometimes the more automation you have, the more technology you have, it could end up with more investment is injected and more job creation in place because you are diversifying your work. But I do not have a clear answer of what is going to be happening in the future, but from the what's happening in the countries now, with like in Japan, like in Europe, like in the United States, those countries are enjoying the highest level of automation and the highest level of technology, but they still have the lowest level of unemployment. While those countries, they have less automation and less technology, they have a high level of unemployment. This is just what you can see around. So I'm not sure whether more technology, you might have like a U-shape. When you reach a technology at a level, it could have a negative impact on unemployment. But at least, if you're talking from emerging countries, I would like to see Egypt, for example, to have more automation, more technology, more knowledge transfer from developed countries, because I'm sure about this is could replace some of imports from outside with some things that could be manufacturing inside Egypt, and this could provide more job creation.
Let's continue here, and then we've got a bunch of questions. But okay.
Hello, my name is Jagruthi. I'm a master's student with the ICD. So you mentioned that economics and human rights have an indirect connection. They've not directly mentioned it. But do you think that when a country believes in labor unions or follows minimum wages or talks about productivity and ergonomics, do you think that is kind of a direct relation between economics and human rights, even though it's not explicitly mentioned?
In a sense, it is, because we said one of the human rights is your accountability, and one of the human rights is how you're treating your people. And one of them is the equality, empowering women at work, and to achieve some sort of acceptable lifestyle and acceptable work environment. And one of the acceptable work environment is to be able, through your union, is to defend your rights. But to defend your rights in a way that is by striking balance between your rights and the economic situation of your company, for example. So in reality, yes, the more rights you have, that will make the management taking your needs in the decision-making process just to achieve some sort of balance between the goals and the objective of the company itself and the goal and the objective of workers in this company. And I think if we can reach some sort of agreement, that will be for the benefit of both workers as well as the company at large.
And I have one more question. You spoke about how there's a need for minorities to be represented in job creation and job market, and not only having elites get most of the jobs. But then when you talk about reservation in countries like India, where they have reservations for minorities in the public sector since 2 decades, and now the minorities have been uplifted, and I have first-hand experience with that, do you think that is in direct contradiction with the human rights of the majority of public, which does not get an opportunity to work in the public sector because of the reservation of minority?
I mean, it's not about getting the right to work in the public sector or not. What I believe is that it is not the issue to reserve a minimum or a percentage for the marginalized group to work in a certain public sector, because this is creates a market distortion. But what I believe more is that you need to give every citizen a chance for health, education, job market. So the issue of treating citizen equally is very important. So this should be based on merit, on skills, but not on the relationship, especially among elite people or politically well-connected people. So the reality is that human rights means give every citizen the chance to participate in the economy, in this country in which they are living, and everything should be based on merit, not based on a relationship. This is what I would like to say.
Okay, we'll come to the final question now, because we're now 30 minutes behind schedule, so I will have to start to be stricter. But last question for now, and then we'll continue.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Do you consider that access to financial resources is a kind of human rights? And in this way of thinking, do you think that it's a need to empower the people how to access to this resource? Because it's difficult to a person that lives in many places around the world to access to this financial, to start a new Google, for example. That this is a big gap to access to the big research that is the main research in the world, that is access to this, to make develop your own ideas everywhere.
Right. I mean, as I was mentioning, it is very important that everybody will have the right in his country. And one of them, for example, is the access to finance. So instead of having, and that was one of the problems, actually, you find that if you look to the banking sector in a country like Egypt, for example, you find that 92% of the loans provided from the banking sector to the private sector is going to the large companies, while only 8% to the small and medium-sized enterprises. Although, in a country like Egypt as well, and for example, in Japan, in many other countries, even developed countries, you'll find 70 to 80% of GDP growth rate is coming from small and medium-sized enterprises. Employment, 70, 80% is coming from small and medium-sized enterprises. So in reality, you'll find unbalance between the access to finance for small and medium-sized compared with large companies. So this is why recently decision makers trying to facilitate access to finance, access for all. So it is not only for giant project, but also for small, medium size, and also for the microfinance. Now you find many initiatives around the globe talking about microfinance, and I think the poor bank, or what's called, I know it's an Arab called Bank al-Fuqara, or poor bank by Mohammed, the guy from Bangladesh. Yeah. So this is very important, is just for the human rights, again, is not only about your to exercise your rights in voting in the election, but many other things. Your right for better health, better education, access to finance, job market is very important, very complicated issue, but I hope that whenever we are moving forward, especially in emerging market, we can have more access to finance to the marginalized group.
Okay, well, on that note, please express our sincere gratitude to Mr. Mohammed Omran. Thank you very, very much.